The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of his heart through all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Good morning and welcome to Northcliffe Union Church Online, a place to celebrate community. Thank you from our food parcel ministry for your continued support in donating non-perishable dry groceries, tinned food, household cleaning products and personal toiletries. Please drop off your donations at the church from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday to Friday. This month's edition of the Highlight magazine is available for you to read or download from our website or our Facebook page, as well as a link in the description section on our YouTube channel. Catch up with the NUC News. Please send an email to our Pastoral Secretary, Gail Gebhard, on her email address gail@nuchurch.org.za if you would like to be baptized when it is safe to do so. Thank you.
Lord, we thank you so much for the incredible privilege we have of prayer. Such a wonderful reality that we can engage with you, not just with words, but with our hearts and by the work of your Spirit, we can connect with you in this wonderful way and help us always to remember that prayer is a two-way street. It's not just giving you a shopping list or talking to you, but it's listening to you as we read your word, as we develop our ability to hear that small, still whisper of the Spirit and to be obedient to the way that you lead us. And thank you, Lord, for the privilege we have of approaching the throne of grace on behalf of our brothers and sisters in the country of Morocco. We know, Lord, that things are very tense and difficult there for Christians, particularly those that come from a Muslim background. Lord, we don't know. We have no idea what it's like to be an absolutely invisible person in society, to be ignored and despised and ostracized, to lose everything. Your word's very clear that we must be willing to lose everything to follow you. Take up your cross daily, our cross daily, and follow you. But we have no idea what that means. But our brothers and sisters in Morocco are living that out every day. And so, Lord, we're humble as we pray for them, and it's too easy for us to take this lightly. But we thank you that we can pray with them and for them. That they'll know your strength, that they'll know your comfort, that they'll know that their identity is secured forever in Christ, that they are valued, that they are loved, no matter how they're treated in their families or in their community or by their state. We pray for those, Lord, who, even as we pray, are being tortured for their faith, for others who are being enticed and tempted to walk away from Christ. Lord, may they know your presence, may they know your strength, may they know your joy, and may they continue to be faithful, even as they ask us to pray that they persevere. May they be faithful in their walk for you. Build your church, Lord, in that country, and may your name be worshipped and honored. Bring those who hate you and who oppress others and torture, bring them to their knees in submission and surrender to King Jesus. We thank you that we can pray this all in that matchless, powerful, eternal name, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hey, it's good to be with you again. I hope you're comfortable. I decided if you're going to be comfortable, I'm going to get myself more comfortable. And we can just have a chat as we look at God's Word together this morning. And I want to start by telling you an incredible story about a missionary couple who went to a tribe in Papua New Guinea in 1962 to reach out to headhunting a cannibalistic tribe with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They arrived there with a few meager belongings and a seven-month-old child and began to live with the Sawi tribe and build relationship with them, learn their language, and the purpose of that was to share the gospel, to share Jesus with them. But they discovered as they began to live with them and tell them the story of Jesus and the whole story of the crucifixion, that the tribe applauded Judas, because in their worldview, in their culture, treachery and deception is a very high value. And they actually would deceive friends and fatten them up to kill them. So if a member of the Sawi tribe invites you for lunch, the chances are you probably are the lunch. So when they heard the story of Judas and his betrayal, they actually applauded and cheered for Judas. And Don Richardson and his wife Carol, the missionaries, were absolutely overwhelmed and dismayed how are we ever going to reach these people for Christ? And they were so discouraged, they were on the verge of leaving and going home and giving up and seeing the whole purpose and plan there as being a failure. But while they were still there, war broke out between the tribe with whom they lived and the neighboring tribe. And it was bloodthirsty, it was vicious, and there was a lot of casualties, a lot of death. And they were seeking to try and live amongst this war, this tribal war, and care for the sick and the dying and the on both sides, which got them into some trouble with the tribe that they were staying with, the Sawi tribe. But it came to a point where they realized, these two tribes realized, that they weren't going to be able to actually defeat one or the other, and they needed a peace treaty. But the only way in their culture to achieve a peace treaty is if the chief of one tribe takes a newborn child, a newborn son, and gives that to the wife of the chief of the other tribe. And so they had this big ceremony, all the warriors there and all their weaponry, and they stood lined up next to each other, and they took the baby from the Sawi chief's wife and walked across that line, that no man's land, that area, and handed that infant to the wife of the chief of the other tribe. And obviously the mother, who's now losing her child, was weeping and on the ground crying and begging and pleading, didn't want to release that child. But she absolutely had to. There was no other way for them to achieve peace. And the conditions of this peace treaty were that as long as that child is alive, there'd be peace between the two tribes. When that child died, whether it's young or old, they'd be at war again. And in the middle of this heart-wrenching reality of casualty and war and death, and then watching this mother lose her child for the sake of peace between these tribes, Don and Carol Richardson realized that is how we tell the story of the gospel. Jesus is the peace child, that the great warrior of heaven surrendered, gave over to mankind. And as long as that child is alive, there's peace between God and humanity. And as we know, and as Isaiah speaks so beautifully here in Isaiah 9, he lives forever, and so there is peace between God and man. And I was thinking about that amazing story. It touched my heart years ago. As a youngster, I became aware of this story. There's a book now and a movie called The Peace Child, which tells it so beautifully. And when I was reading Isaiah 9, the second part of the passage that we started looking at last week, where it speaks about the Prince of Peace, I was reminded of this incredible, incredible story, real life story, of the peace child. So let's move into the scripture that we started with last week and spend some more time looking at God's word. And grab your Bibles, whatever version you have, whether it's a hard copy or a digital, and we'll read verses 1 to 7 of Isaiah chapter 9, just to refresh our thinking and then to focus on verses 6 to 7. So Isaiah 9 says, "Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the Gentiles by the way of the sea along the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light, and those living in the land of the shadow of death, on those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, You have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born. To us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne forever. Let me finish this passage. Establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever, and the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. And that last phrase is very, very significant in terms of God fulfilling his purpose, and we're going to look at that just now. But let's focus on verses 6 and 7. To us a child is born, a son is given, the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. As God, or as Isaiah, obedient to God, moved by the Spirit of God, spoke these words, and as they were recorded, God is sending a message to mankind, a profound and actually the ultimate message. And we started last week looking at this theme, the dawn of the new day. And what God does through Isaiah, some 700 years before Christ comes to earth, is declare what he's going to do and how he's going to do it. And obviously, we have hindsight and we have a lot of detail that Isaiah didn't have. But when we look back through the lenses of Christ and the cross and the resurrection and the ascension and the message of the New Testament, we find the key to unlock what to people in the Old Testament was a mystery. And Paul refers to that mystery over and over again in his writings. What Isaiah is sharing with us, as he's used by the Spirit of God, is that he is talking about, and God is talking about, the supreme ruler. We're familiar with the phrases King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we kind of bandy these around without actually realizing what we are talking about. Jesus is the supreme ruler. And as we'll see as we look at Isaiah 11 in the future, this is the message of the kingdom of God through and through. And the language of this passage is very clear. The government will be on his shoulders. Now, in ancient times and even in modern times, people of rank wear that on their shoulders. The royal robes, even when we see the royal family in their regalia, they wear robes and uniforms that are so elaborate. And what all of that is telling you is that we are in charge. We are the rulers of our kingdom. So this language is familiar to us and to the ancients. The government will be on his shoulders. I remember as a youngster growing up, part of my childhood in Durban, and from time to time, we would have the mayor of our town come to church. And he always came with an entourage. And he would walk into our church building with that mayoral chain around his neck, and he'd be welcomed to the service. Everybody else was welcome, but he was really welcomed. And I even wondered as a child, like, if you really want to come to church, why do you have to wear the chain? Why don't you just come along? But people like us to see their rank and their status. There was a saying in the military when I was in the Air Force, and I cannot confirm or deny whether I subscribe to it or not, but they used to say, what's the difference between the circus and the military? Well, in the circus, you wave at the clowns, and in the military, you salute them. Now, I'm not saying I subscribe to that necessarily, but the rank, the military, the officers would always have their rank on their shoulders, well, a scrambled egg on their shoulders. So we're familiar with this picture, and this scripture says that the government, of which there will be no end, will be on his shoulders. He is the supreme ruler. And when we read these four names, these incredibly descriptive names, it can be a little confusing because we read about the wonderful counsel, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Now, Prince is an important person in the world's eyes, but he's not the king. And I've always wondered, why would Jesus be called the Prince of Peace and not the King of Peace in this passage? Until I took the time to go and check the original language, the Hebrew, and this word that's translated prince for us means a king, a ruler, or a chief. So it's very much in line with the supreme authority that is rightfully on the shoulders of Jesus. Remember in the Great Commission, at the end of Matthew's Gospel, Jesus says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." The government is on his shoulders. I will build my kingdom, and hell cannot stop me. It's a wonderful reality for us that the government's on his shoulders, particularly, and this is universal authority. He's the cosmic king, not just the mayor of a little town or the despot in a totalitarian state or a crooked former president who now sits in jail. He is the ultimate authority. And in the crisis and the chaos in our country at the moment, and it's, I think we're all just, maybe we've reached a level of fatigue in terms of compassion and things, because COVID, the pandemic, and now the violence and the looting, and there's just so much going on. It's understandable if we're tempted to think no one's in charge, no one's in control, and we might even wonder if God is still in control. But the reign of Christ is not affected by what man may do or not do. Whether man acknowledges Christ or not, he is the supreme ruler, and scripture tells us in Philippians 2, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So he's supreme. And friends, let's not forget, let's not lose focus. He is still in charge. He's still on the throne. Psalm 2 asks the question in a very mocking voice, why do the people of the earth, why do the rulers rage? Why do they try to rebel against God the King? It's a useless endeavor. What this passage also talks about, and particularly in the way it describes these four names, it speaks of a supernatural relationship that God will reveal. And there was traces of that, there was evidence of that in the Old Testament, there's no doubt, right from Eden, right through the Exodus in the Promised Land. God, there's a supernatural relationship. God makes a declaration that runs throughout Scripture and is fulfilled in their revelation. I will be their God, they will be my people, and I will live with them. And this is, it's a miracle that we can have a relationship with God. And we have these wonderfully descriptive names. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And the word wonderful here is actually speaks of supernatural. It speaks of that which is beyond human ability or understanding. And what we have coupled in every one of these names is the divine and the human nature of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the supernatural counselor. He's the mighty God. He's not just God, he's the mighty God. He's not just the counselor, he's the miraculous, the supernatural. And we know the language of the New Testament where Jesus says, I will send the counselor, the comforter. That being the Holy Spirit, the everlasting Father. Now, you know, we know as people, even our most precious and our most special relationships, for some of us, those are with our fathers, and sadly for others, they're not. But we know sooner or later we're going to have to say goodbye to these people. And even as I want, as a father, to always be there for my kids, of course, you know, I only get to share advice when it's asked for these days. But I'm happy to be available as a free consultant whenever the need arises. But I want to be there for my boys. But I won't always be there for them. But the one that's promised in Scripture is the everlasting Father. And the ruler, or the chief, the king of peace. These are supernatural relationships. And every religion in the world speaks in some way or some form about relationship with a supreme being, a higher power, a relationship with the divine. But it's always out of reach. It's always just over the hill. It's like the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. It promises much, but delivers absolutely nothing, and actually creates such disillusionment and frustration that people are really silently suffering in their hopelessness. But God promises to us, in the words of this ancient prophet, this supernatural relationship. And that comes to fulfillment in Christ. As we look back through history, through the lenses of Scripture, through the lenses of the New Testament, we see that in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And remember that when the birth of Christ is announced to the world, the angels don't go to Rome to speak to Caesar or to Herod. They go to shepherds, the outcasts of society, watching their sheep, guarding their sheep against predators and thieves at night. And they declare glad tidings, peace on earth, and goodwill to men. And we used a little saying last week, know him. If we know him, we know peace. If we don't know him, we don't know peace. And we look at that promise at the birth of Christ, the announcement of the angel, and we say, well, peace on earth, goodwill to men. Where on earth is that, Lord? But it takes a surrendering to the supreme ruler. You see, this every peace treaty has conditions. And if we don't submit, if we don't surrender, we don't receive his peace. As Paul says in Philippians, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests. Bring your burdens, bring your brokenness, present your requests to God. In other words, empty your heart, empty your hands, bring it to the Lord, leave it at his feet. And the peace of God, which goes beyond all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. We can't receive the peace of God, the peace of Christ, when we're holding things in our hands, when we're trying to barter and negotiate, well, I'll let go of this, but I won't let go of this. No, we have to surrender. And we must understand this in light of the message of Scripture. He's the ruler of peace. And if we want to know peace, and we all want peace, we must surrender to the King. But it's the best thing we can do. The message of the gospel is that we win when we lose. We win when we wave the white flag and surrender our souls and our lives to the only one who is worthy, to the only one who is able, to the only one who keeps his promises, because he's faithful and true. And what this passage underlines when we get to the end of verse 7 is that this is all guaranteed by the sovereign zeal of the Lord. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty, the zeal of Yahweh, the Lord of hosts, the commander of the armies of heaven. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. This is, in God's economy, this is as good as done. And that word zeal speaks of ardor and even jealousy. When Scripture says our God is a jealous God, it uses this word zeal. And when we hear jealousy, we think that's wrong. How can God be jealous? But God is the only one who is justified in his jealousy, because unlike all the despots that have ever tried to rule the world, he is worthy of worship and worthy of honor and worthy of our surrender and worthy of praise. I've started watching a fascinating series on Netflix called How to Become a Dictator. And what it's very well done. And what they do is profile, using examples of well-known despots, Hitler, Idi Amin, Gaddafi, Stalin, and others. They profile how you become a dictator and rule your country. And they're all obviously pathological. They're all narcissistic megalomaniacs who will do whatever. They'll kill go back in history, some of the Caesars slaughtered their own mothers, their own family members, to make sure they stayed on the throne. That's what tyrants will do. But notice that the way that Jesus wins and the way he reigns and rules forever is through grace and mercy and love. Let's just read again these beautiful names. He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there'll be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. And the zeal, the ardor, the passion of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. And if I was to paraphrase Isaiah might have said, don't mess with the king. He's doing his thing. He's going to win. He's won. It's complete. It's done. And he always accomplishes his purpose perfectly and right on time. And as much as we want peace, particularly now, in time of such turmoil, we need to recognize that in the message of Scripture, Old and New Testament, it's a package deal. If you don't surrender, you don't get peace. And we don't get peace on our terms. But we need to realize that Scripture is saying that God is the initiator of peace. This supreme ruler who offers in Christ the supernatural relationship that is more than we could ever ask or even imagine or comprehend. Paul says the love of God is so high and wide and deep, it's beyond understanding, and yet we can experience it in our lives and in our hearts. But it's a package deal. We need to, as Psalm 2 says, kiss the Son. We must surrender. And I can't overemphasize the fact that it's absolutely the best thing we can do. There's no offer like it. Now, just to finish off the story or give you some more detail about the story of the Peace Child, and I'd encourage you to look it up, watch the movie, read the book, and this follow-up to that. God, after that whole thing took place with the chief surrendering his son, tearing that baby away from his mother's arms and giving it to the wife of the enemy tribe at that point, the Richardsons had such phenomenal opportunity to share the gospel using that contextual example, that tribe, the vast majority of that tribe, came to faith and began to witness about the true peace child to other tribes in that area. And some 50 years after all these things took place, Don and Carol retired, went home. And some 50 years later, he went back to that Sawi tribe in Papua New Guinea with his son, who was 7 months old at the time, and with his two younger brothers. So Don and his three boys went back to visit that tribe, and they were still walking with Jesus. Now that is discipleship. That's kingdom discipleship. They were still walking with Jesus. And Don, at the age of 77, had the privilege of being part of a baptismal service where him and elders of the tribe, who are now elders in the church, baptized some 50 people at one time who had come to faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Wow. What an amazing privilege for that faithful man of God. So I leave that story with you. And hopefully we'll use that story to challenge us in our own context. What is it going to take for us to fulfill the mandate of God in our lifetime, in our community, in our homes, in our society? But let me just encourage you, the new day has dawned. We live in the reality of the kingdom of God. And no matter what people do, no matter what happens to this country, and please, Lord, may it stabilize and sanity be restored and the economy be rescued, and may the grieving people of this nation know the comfort of the wonderful Counselor. But whatever happens, we must never forget that when we surrender, we win. And to know Him, to know Christ, is to know peace. Father, how we thank You for Your Word, and how we thank You for these incredible examples that we have in history of faithful servants who have given up everything to take the message of the gospel, the reality of the reign of King Jesus, far and wide. And we thank You for the hope that we have in You, knowing that in You we have absolute assurance and absolute security for all eternity. And Lord, may everyone who hears this message be absolutely assured of that, not by anything I've said, but by the work of Your Holy Spirit within their lives. And may we live today and every day for You and for Your glory. For from You and through You and to You are all things. To God be the glory forever and ever. Amen.